Welcome to e-Pathshala, Module 28 of Applied Linguistics course. The module title is Multilingualism and Language Teaching. The classrooms across the world are by default multilingual. That is, students of various first language could be present in that class. Now, the degree of multilinguality may vary from class to class. It could vary from mutually comprehensible varieties of a language to a mutually incomprehensible language. Though classrooms are by default multilingual, our pedagogical paradigms are fundamentally located in monolinguality. So that is, what we usually see is in a classroom, that there is a particular language that is focused on. Every mode of communication in that classroom would be in that language. The teachers teach in that language. The textbooks are written in that language. Notes are taken by students in that language. And the students communicate to each other in that language. This model results in the silencing of voices of millions of students who are already socially and economically marginalized. In this module, we try to show an alternative pedagogical paradigm rooted in multilinguality. And in this module, we are trying to show that it is indeed possible to have multilingually rooted pedagogical system. For various reasons, people get carried away by the concept of a language, believing in an almost frozen object in time and space being uniformly used by a homogeneous speech community. A community needs a language name for its identity. The notions of statehood and nationhood are deeply tied to a language. More than anybody else, it is the prescriptive grammarians who are responsible for consolidating and perpetuating the concept of a language. Now let's see the case of India, multilinguality in India. The facts about India being a multilingual country are well known. The 1961 census, which can legitimately be considered the most authentic in this respect, recorded a total of 1,652 languages belonging to four different language families in this country. Over 87 languages are used in the print media, 71 languages are used on radio, and the administration of the country is conducted in 13 different languages. However, the number of home language being used as a media of instruction in schools is failing rapidly. The 1999 NCERT survey showed that only 41 languages are used in schools, either as medium of instruction or taught as subject. Pandit 1969, 1972, 1988 has shown how variability in linguistic behavior facilitates rather than breaks down communication in multilingual societies. Our educational system should make every conceivable effort to sustain multilingualism. Patnaik, 1981, has argued how our educational system has consistently weakened the advantages of grassroots multilingualism that characterizes our society. Education planners in this country should pay immediate attention to the centrality of language in education before it is too late. We need to make every possible effort to empower the language of the underprivileged and tribal and endangered languages. Affirmative action is called for in this domain. The three language formula that has been reinforced by a variety of educational commissions should be seen in this context. It is with a sense of regret we note that the three language formula has rarely been implemented in its true spirit anywhere in the country. We therefore suggest that rather than a strict implementation of the three language formula, it is a survival and maintenance of multilingualism that should be at the heart of language planning in this country. Several experiments have now been made to demonstrate the effectiveness of a pedagogy rooted in multilingualism. In India, NCERT's Evaluation of Multilingualism Education, that is MLE, in Odisha, and the NMRC Longitudinal Study of MLE in Andhra Pradesh and Odisha show multiple academic and social benefits of mother tongue-based multilingual education. These days, translation, translanguaging, code mixing, undercoding, etc. are becoming central to applied linguistics. For a very long time, it was believed that bilingualism has a negative relationship with cognitive growth and scholastic achievement. For example, Zaire in 1923 tried to show that the 7 to 14 year old Welsh English speaking bilinguals have lower IQ than compared to their monolingual counterparts. However, this is no more the case. Several recent studies have now convincingly shown that there is a highly positive relationship between bilingualism, multilingualism, and scholastic achievement. Highly positive relationship between bilingualism, cognitive flexibility, metacognition, and scholastic achievement. Several recent studies have now convincingly shown that there is a very strong, highly positive relationship between bilingualism, cognitive flexibility, metacognition, and scholastic achievement. Bilingual and multilingual children not only have control over several different languages, but they also have very good academic and creative ability. The wide range of linguistic repertoire that they control equips them to negotiate different social situations more efficiently than monolinguals. There is also substantial evidence to show that multilingual children excel in divergent thinking. In that case, there is every reason to promote multilingualism in school curricula. Cummins and Swain have made a very fundamental distinction between basic interpersonal communicative skills and cognitive academic language proficiency. The language ability that is associated with basic interpersonal communicative skills largely involves the skills to perform effectively in social conditions, social communication situations that are rich in context and less demanding at the level of cognition. The language of here and there, the language of family, language of peer community, peer group interaction belongs to this domain of communication. CALP level abilities are needed to perform effectively in contextually poor and cognitively demanding situations. They would generally be acquired in tutored language settings. For example, when a secondary or semi-secondary student is asked to write an essay on a topic with which he or she is not familiar, or to read newspaper editorial to critique it, he or she may have to invoke his or her CALP level abilities. These abilities get effectively transferred from one language to another, particularly when the level of developed competence in a language is high. Successive multilingual education programs in Andhra Pradesh and Orissa have drawn international attention, and our neighboring countries such as Nepal have molded their MLE programs on the basis of Indian MLE. Other SAARC countries have also launched programs of MLE. It is also encouraging that Odisha now has a policy of implementation of MLE for tribal children in the state. The programs in Andhra Pradesh and Odisha now cover 27 tribal languages and over 4,000 schools. The teacher's sensitivity towards multiplicity of language, linguistic diversity within and across languages, and children's natural exposure to multilingual environments must be given emphasis. Since there are classrooms with children for multiple mother tongues in most part of the country, there is a need to engage in MLE pedagogy for multiple language classrooms. We will now discuss some examples of engaging with multilinguality in the classroom. All these activities will automatically raise metacognitive level of awareness about the nature and structure of language, which has been shown to be positively correlated with language proficiency and scholastic achievement. The process that is generally adopted in them is one of the scientific inquiry, which is data collection, data classification and categorization, data analysis, reflection and hypothesis formation, and finally hypothesis verification. Now let us discuss certain activities that could be done in a multilingual classroom. The first one is language analysis. The teacher could begin with a few examples of any grammatical processes, such as number change, that is singular to plural, or subject verb agreement, or negative formation, or any such grammatical process. After a few examples, you can ask the children to apply these rules in their language. For example, in India, one of the target languages is English. The teacher could explain all the grammatical processes in English. For example, the teacher could begin with words like cat, cats, dog, dogs, bus, buses, bat, bats, etc. And the teacher can explain what is happening in these words. The singular word cat, when the sound sir is added to the singular word cat, the plural form cats is formed. So now we should tell the children that they must focus on the sound with which a particular word ends. And the teacher can also tell them to focus on the sounds that may be added to make them plural. Later, children can be split into groups in which different languages are represented. And the children should be asked to classify the words in their list in different categories and go on to formulate rules for making plurals in their language. So in such an activity, accuracy of rules is not the immediate objective. The process of inquiry and total participation is what we should focus on. Another activity that could be done in a multilingual classroom is translation. Now, for example, imagine a classroom in which there are 2 to 3 Naga children are present, and most often their voices are not heard. The teacher can ask one of the Naga students to recite 2 lines of a folk song in their language, and the Naga children collectively can translate the main meaning of these lines into the language most children in that classroom share. Children can be again split into different groups, and the 2 lines of the Naga song are rendered into different languages. There are multiple advantages in doing such an activity in a multilingual classroom. Importantly, the voices of marginalized children find a space, their voice is heard, focuses on meaning, respect and tolerance of other culture. Another important activity that could be done in a multilingual classroom is praise writing. This is different from the standard model of summarizing a text to its 1/3. In this case, what children do is to split into group, read the text carefully, understand it and produce a smaller text with the main points in their languages. In such texts, chord mixing, translanguaging, and undercoding are seen as assets and creative strategies rather than as major mistakes to be eradicated. Working on picture stories, role play, converting text from one kind of genre to another in different languages, etc., could be some of the other activities that could be done in a multilingual classroom. There is no limit to the texts available in the material and literary world, which are often multilingual and even multi-scripted. There is no doubt that a certain kind of qualitatively different teacher training is required, in which all teachers are sensitized to the nature and structure of language, learning potential of the child, and the strategies children use to learn and share. All teachers need this kind of training because language spreads across the curriculum. It is only through such training that children will at once acquire proficiency in the target language and also gain the conceptual clarity that is necessary for each domain of knowledge. In this module, we discuss the importance of pedagogical paradigm rooted in multilinguality. Recent works in bilingualism shows that it is related to cognitive flexibility, metacognition, and scholastic achievement. We also learn to use multilingualism as a classroom resource. Certain activities such as linguistic analysis, translation, phrase writing, role play, etc. can help in using multilingualism as a classroom resource. Another important thing that we discussed in this module is that all teachers should have special training, and it is only through such training that children will at once acquire proficiency in the target languages and also gain conceptual clarity. Thank you.